As we begin our Advent service, let us pray. If you'd like to join in with the words in bold. As we light our Advent candle, light of the world, shine on us. As we prepare for Christmas time, light of the world, shine on us. In this world of pain and darkness, light of the world, shine through us. to all the people who don't know you. Light of the world, shine through us. Jesus, you are coming again. Light of the world, light the way. In our service here today, light of the world, light the way.
Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.
As we lead into a time of confession, let us just pause for a moment, reflect on the week gone by and the week ahead. Advent God, we journey with you to Bethlehem's stable and a newborn king. Ears attuned to the song of angels, eyes alert for Bethlehem's star. Lord, forgive us if on our journey we are distracted by the tempting offers of this world. Keep our hearts aflame with the hope of Christmas and the promise of a Saviour. Amen. We believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth, the one who is full of patience, who is not afraid of silence, who does not need to fill each moment with activity and noise. The one who is beyond bluster and flurry, and who does not jostle for attention. We believe in God the Son, Saviour of creation, who slipped into Bethlehem one night, mostly unnoticed, who lived 30 years without headlines or hurry, who frequently took time alone with his patient father, who waited for the right time to become the suffering servant, who stood quietly before the noise of his accusers, whose silence overpowered their words, who died, then rose again on a quiet Sunday morning. We believe in God, the Holy Spirit, who strengthens, empowers, renews and refreshes, sometimes arriving with obvious power, sometimes with the quiet breath of a whisper. We believe in one God, who patiently waits for us, and who longs for us to do the same. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendour. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. for I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. In my faithfulness, I will reward my people and make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants will be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them will acknowledge that they are a people the Lord has blessed. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness, as a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the sprout come up, and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the Sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Preparing for Jesus means much more than setting aside time or dusting off the nativity set. It's more than setting aside time to reread the story of his birth, even though those things are important. Could it be that these things could evolve into just a tradition that we keep at a specific time of year? It may make us feel good. It may make us feel nostalgic. Maybe we even feel holy. Good and important as these preparations are, they aren't enough as we prepare for Jesus. Preparing for Jesus means remembering what he was about. It's not about adding another thing to an already busy Christmas list. Preparing for Jesus is about pausing and remembering the message that this little baby will grow up to give. Good news to the poor, binding up the brokenhearted, proclaiming freedom for the captives, comforting those who mourn. For many, this time of year can feel unbearable. Whilst others celebrate, gather with families, buy lots of stuff, eat lots of stuff, for some, Christmas just hurts, and the celebrations are a reminder of their loss, loneliness, or struggle. But we know that Jesus came to heal the world of its brokenness. So if we truly want to follow him, if we truly are preparing for him, shouldn't we all be following in his footsteps and being part of the healing of brokenness? Shouldn't his message be ours? Shouldn't we look like Jesus to the world who needs him? How much more does the world, do we, need that message this year? Dare I challenge a little bit further and ask, does the world around us see us as people whom God has made and continues to make a difference in? In our reading today, it mentions the garments of salvation, or a robe of righteousness, that we wear because of us following God. But do these garments seem like just another Christmas sweater to others? Or is this something that we wear all year? Now that's quite a challenge for us all. As we prepare our hearts for Jesus, do we remember the prayerful and faithful lives of Simeon and Anna? Do we, like David, seek God's path? When we try to look like Jesus, but leave behind his message of good news, the world doesn't see a genuine article. God loves justice and he hates wrongdoing. This is true in the here and now as well as the hereafter. Christianity is a faith in the incarnate God, the God who lived among us as one of us because he cares deeply for us. That is the gift of Christmas, and one that should change our lives forever. Isaiah is clear in our passage today as to what that looks like. The hope of Jesus is not merely a hope for tomorrow. It is a hope that begins now, stretches into eternity, and makes a difference to every day. Look at your hands. Who are they for? Have they had a year like this one before? Have they washed and scrubbed and sanitized, got dry and sore and moisturized? Have they done less work, been at home more, or have they worked harder than ever before? Have they helped a neighbour, a parent or friend? Have they longed for all these restrictions to end? Have they missed friends, felt too far apart? Have they lost a loved one and clutched at your heart? This Christmas is different. It can't be the same. The world all around us has obviously changed. But the meaning of Christmas, the heart of it all, began in a baby so precious and small. With no glitz or sparkle, no parties or feasts, he came for the broken, the lonely, the least. The hands of his earth dad were dusty and worn, hardened by woodwork, but chosen for more. The hands of his mother was softer but weary, holding her baby, eyes happy but teary. The hands of the shepherds who visited first were rough and strong and ingrained with dirt. The hands of the angels were lifted in praise to the one we call Saviour, the Ancient of Days. To the babe whose smooth hands, so weak and so small, would one day carry the wrongs of us all, so that every person on earth may know how much they are loved by how far he would go to rescue, redeem, forgive and restore, to give us the life we were born for, a life of meaning, of joy, peace and love, as we walk hand in hand with our Father above. So whether your heart is heavy or light, with hands held open or screwed up tight, whether they're full or empty or tired, work-worn or restless or uninspired, just know that you don't have to be alone to carry your burdens and trials on your own. Jesus came to walk by your side, to fill you with hope, to be your guide. Look at your hands. Who are they for? If they take hold of Jesus, they'll need nothing more. Lord, in this advent of expectation, may you draw us together in unity, that our praise and worship might echo in these walls and also through our lives. In this advent of expectation, may you draw us together in mission, that the hope within might be the song we sing and the melody of our lives. In this advent of expectation, draw us together in service, that the path we follow might lead us from a stable to a glimpse of eternity. This Advent time, we remember Mary and Joseph, giving thanks for their faithfulness, courage, and obedience, stepping out into the unknown in the strength of your spirit, playing their part in the fulfilment of your plan to bring your prodigal people home again. We pray that their example might be a pattern of our lives, that when your gentle whisper breaks through the clamour of this world and into our small corner, we might be ready to listen, and having listened, to act. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Pray a blessing upon you. God of hope, who brought love into this world, be the love that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought peace into the world, be the peace that dwells between us. God of hope, who brought joy into this world, be the joy that dwells between us. God of hope, the rock we stand upon, be the centre, the focus of our lives always. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us forever. Amen.